Viewers, I've always told you that without the influence of Pakistan, without the poisonous words whispered into their ears by separatists, without the rabble-rousing of mainstream Kashmiri political leaders, the ordinary Kashmiri has no axe to grind with the Indian state, with New Delhi. I've always told you this, that the reason why Kashmiris pelt stones is not because of some deep-seated hatred towards the Indian state. It's because some of them are constantly misled, brainwashed by rumor mongers, by fear mongers, and most importantly, by the Pakistani misinformation slash propaganda machine. Now, what have you been hearing, viewers, over the last few weeks? You have been told that if the Modi government was to revoke, dilute Article 370, Kashmir would explode into a fireball, that the Indian state would be, and the idea of India would be charred, that there would be mayhem in the streets. Many have predicted that there would be widespread chaos in Kashmir if the center scrapped Article 370. But this is not so. It's been 48 hours. 72, if you were to consider the Governor General's big hint on Article 370 going. But has there been large-scale, widespread violence, viewers? And don't tell me that there is no violence, because there is a police force that has been deployed in Kashmir. We've had the police, we've had the army, we've had army in the cities, yet there has been violence. Now, we are going to show you, viewers, and you're going to hear for yourselves, ordinary Kashmiris extolling the virtues of peace, welcoming normalcy. They haven't got any complaints against the Modi government. And I can also tell you this, that on Friday, when prohibitory orders are lifted, all those elements who are on the payrolls of third parties like Pakistan and separatists, they will instigate people, threaten them to come out in large numbers. If there was really, viewers, a problem with the Modi government's move to dilute Article 370, which force in the world would have stopped the spontaneous anger of the ordinary Kashmiri? There would have been no force big enough to do it. They would have come out, but they haven't. They haven't, viewers. In fact, National Security Advisor Ajit Doval is today in Shopian, the most disturbed area, supposedly, in the valley. And he's speaking to ordinary Kashmiris. In fact, he's eating biryani with them. Yes, he's asking the locals, do you have a problem? First, listen to some of these voices, viewers, that we captured on our cameras and some of our reporters captured on their cameras. Listen to the real voices of Kashmir, the ones that have not been influenced by the fearmongers or brainwashed by the radicals or those that are loyal to Pakistan. Listen to this.
हमारे गांव में जो भी है करप्शन वगैरह या जो अपने स्टेट में ये कम हो जाएगी और दूसरा हमारा ये है कि मैं बिल्कुल रंगवाड़ का रहने वाला हूं डिस्ट्रिक्ट कुपवाड़ा रंगवाड़ का रहने वाला हूं बिल्कुल मेरे साथ मतलब फौज से थोड़ा दूर हूं लेकिन कुछ भी मेरा गांव के अंदर बिल्कुल शांति है कोई पत्थरबाजी नहीं है कोई हड़ताल नहीं है कोई कुछ
कम से कम ये जो गुंडा राज है करप्शन है ये खत्म होगा
जो जुल्म था हमारे पे वो कम होगा
ये डेवलपमेंट होगा अंदाजा ऐसा ही लगता है हमारा दूसरा सर हमारे यहां मतलब बगल में एक फौज की एक यूनिट है तो वो कर्फ्यू भी है हालांकि लेकिन फिर भी हमारे बच्चे बीमार हो जाता है या कोई बूढ़ा बीमार हो जाता है तो वो हमारे वो अस्पताल तक ले जाने आने जाने में
मदद करते हैं, मदद करते हैं सर।
हमारा कोई परेशानी नहीं, हम तो ठीक ठाक हैं सर। आप
ये हटने से यहाँ की ज़िंदगी पर क्या फ़र्क पड़ेगा?
कोई फ़र्क नहीं पड़ना, कोई फ़र्क नहीं पड़ना। सब बच्चों को नौकरी मिलेगा, आने वाली नस्ल ठीक रहेगी, सेफ साइड रहेगी, बिल्कुल ठीक है सर। हमारे लिए तो कोई फर्क
नहीं। यहाँ पर डेवलपमेंट इससे भी ज़्यादा होना चाहिए, जितना नहीं है जितना बाहर है, दिल्ली मुंबई उसमें है उतना ज़्यादा यहाँ पर डेवलपमेंट नहीं है। यहाँ पर भी धीरे धीरे डेवलपमेंट हो रही है, होने भी चाहिए।
तरक्की होगी हमारे जे एंड के में इसकी?
जी
तरक्की होगी।
और जैसे बाहर का पैसा आएगा, लोग आएंगे तो रोज़गार बढ़ने के?
रोज़गार बढ़ेगा, फैक्ट्री खुलेगी इधर, रोज़गार बढ़ेगा, तरक्की होगी हमारे जे एंड के की।
आप तो फायदा होगा, तो
फायदा होगा हमें।
भले ही नुकसान हुआ होगा, लोग इस बात में आम लोगों का, कश्मीर की जनता का फायदा है। अगर ये जो अब पैसा आएगा वो डायरेक्ट वहाँ से आएगा जो हम तक पहुँचे, करप्शन जो है वो खत्म हो जाएगी।
ओके,
पहले स्टेट के थ्रू आता था, फिर आस्ता 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 उसको इसने 5% 10% उठाते उठाते यहाँ 5% ही पहुँचता था, 95% ऊपर से ही चला जाता था। अब अगर वहाँ से 100% आएगा तो हमें यकीन है 100% हमें मिलेगा। रोडें बनेंगी, पानी लगेगा, बाकी चीज़ें होंगी, क्योंकि अब दिल्ली डायरेक्ट देखेगी कश्मीर को।
okay.
पहले जैसे हम दिल्ली में जाते थे, इस दफा 370 की वजह से हमें कश्मीरी कहा जाता था, अब शायद इंडियन कहा जाएगा।
जो ये 370 हटाया गया है सर, इससे बहुत फायदा हो जाएगा जम्मू को भी, कश्मीर को भी सर। जो जो भी आने वाले भविष्य है सर, उनके लिए बहुत फायदा हो जाएगा सर। यहाँ जो भी डेवलपमेंट है, आज तक 30 सालों में कोई डेवलपमेंट नहीं हुई, जो भी हुई है पैसा भी आ जाएगा सर, लोगों तक पहुंचेगा सर, गांव-गांव पहुंचेगा सर। ये है कि श्रीनगर में डेवलपमेंट बहुत हो जाएगा सर, डेवलपमेंट इस तरीके से हो जाएगा सर। 2-4 कंपनियां खुलनी चाहिए, और यहाँ लोग जो बेकार हैं, कोई वोटर कंपनी में कोई ऐसे काम करते हैं सर, तो उनको अपना अपना रोजगार मिल जाएगा सर।
नाउ दीज वॉइसेस व्यूअर्स दैट यू जस्ट हर्ड स्पीकिंग टू टाइम्स नाउज रिपोर्टर्स स्पीकिंग द ट्रूथ are voices of those individuals who haven't still been corrupted by the propaganda machines of Pakistan, its proxies, and of course, a whole slew of Kashmiri netas. And what are these voices telling the netas of Kashmir, Pakistan, and Pakistan's proxies? They are saying that we will benefit from the scrapping of Article 370. These are intelligent people. They know when something is going to work in their favor and when something is not going to work in their favor. Have you ever heard Kashmiris this happy, this relieved, this content, this embracing? Yet there are those fearmongers who vow to set fire to the idea of a Naya Kashmir which is rising. Listen to some of these individuals and contrast them. Contrast their words to the words of the ordinary Kashmiri. Listen to this.
You think I will stay inside my house of my own will? While my state is being burnt, while my people are being executed in the jails, punished in their homes. This is not India that I believe in.
All the powers have been taken away from me. Everything has been taken away from me. This is a direct hit at those who believe in the concept of India and Kashmir. It's a typical case of India betraying India in Kashmir.
तो वहाँ का लोगों का देखेंगे कि लोग बहुत परेशान हैं वहाँ। जैसे सुना है हमने, जो टीवी चैनल दिखाते हैं कि बिल्कुल कर्फ्यू है, सारे लीडर बंद हैं, सारे लोग बंद हैं, हाहाकार मचा हुआ अंदर, पता नहीं चलता है, रास्ते पर कोई भी नहीं चलता है, बिल्कुल रोड ब्लॉक्ड है।
You heard it, viewers. These are the netas who are telling you that people are being executed, they are being jailed. And there is evidence that they're out there on the streets and they're coming out and saying that we're very happy. People are being robbed, say some netas. The people are saying, no, we welcome this because this is going to help us. It's going to help us with jobs. Scrapping of Article 370 is going to bring normalcy and peace, and it's going to free us from the corrupt netas that acted as brokers between the Indian state and us and stole everything. Now, viewers, I want to tell you why the people are so relieved today. Here are some hard facts. This is what's going to change, and the people have recognized the new reality. I'll tell you. Naya Kashmir is rising because Removing Article 370 will help in eradicating corruption to a large extent. The Anti-Corruption Bureau will be set up, and with the Lieutenant Governor directly overseeing the Anti-Corruption Bureau, there will be registration of cases. Local patronage of corruption will get a jolt. Transparency acts like the RTI will now apply to Jammu and Kashmir. So netas who are trying to pilfer, deny the people the real benefits of the fruit of their own labor will be caught out. The CNAG will be able to look at the books of the state administration to find out how much money is being diverted, how much not is being diverted. Money will reach now the people directly, bypassing local netas. It's one of the biggest reasons, viewers, that this Article 370 being taken away is filling people with the hope of a Naya Kashmir. There are many other reasons. Law and order, viewers, it's very clear. The police will be under the center, and you will have a situation where cases will be registered. There will be no arbitrary moves to appease stone pelters, etc., by releasing them for votes. And then, of course, employment. The day Article 370's effects kick in, teachers will find that their salaries are now going to be aligned with the salaries in New Delhi. The retirement benefits will be aligned with those retiring in New Delhi. A whole slew of government servants will see their salaries go up. A whole other slew of individuals who are actually dependent on employment in the private sector will also find that their opportunities will increase, because finally businessmen will come and will buy land and set up industries. This is going to be a win-win. And therefore, I want to ask tonight some basic questions of those who have been spreading a poisonous brew of rumors to mislead the honest, innocent people of Jammu and Kashmir. And I want to open this out. Today, I want to ask these fearmonger netas, will they accept that they're spreading rumors by suggesting that the ordinary Kashmiri is angry with Modi's move on 370? And I want to begin by asking Samir Kaul, spokesperson of the National Conference. Dr. Kaul, you are one of those Kashmiris who works in Delhi. You've done very well for yourself, and you have also benefited hundreds and hundreds of people by providing them brilliant services, sir. You're a shining example of how Kashmiris, when given the opportunity, can prosper, shine, and deliver good. And also, in the process, find themselves at ease with the Indian state. Why, sir, are you trying to keep these people away from the same benefits that you have enjoyed, sir, by baking free? I can't understand it, sir. Please explain.
Rahul, since you've been kind enough to present me as the Kashmiri success story, I have to kind of break your heart and say that, like every other Kashmiri, I'm a Kashmiri Pandit and a devout one. I mean, I may not wear it on my sleeve, but I am a devout Kashmiri Pandit, and I am telling you, as a composite of the Kashmiri community, which includes the Pandit, the Sikh, and the Kashmiri Muslim, and you know, JNK has always been a very composite place, with Ladakh and with Jammu being different a bit culturally to Kashmir. But, and it's always been difficult to carry along. It has always been an effort for us and other governments to carry everybody along. But I can tell you that today I share in feeling betrayed and in feeling an assault on my dignity. And of course, something that could have been done with consensus, believing all the things that you talked about in your program, the advantages. But first of all, please always believe that when an event like that happens, it's a major event in our lives, and always comes with some good, it'll come with a lot of bad as well. So there is no fear mongering at all, let me assure you. I reject that, allegation that you made. And I don't speak for all the netas, I don't speak, but I can tell you that the word Naya Kashmir that you used today is actually a copyright of the National Conference, because that is where Sheikh Abdullah brought progressive, forward-thinking, nationalistic, Indian nationalistic viewpoint to the peasant in Kashmir.
If I may,
and
sir.
You know, allow me to present history. History in the real form also. I've listened to all that you've said.
Sir, if
but
I may.
I promise you that today I understand,
sir, if I
jobs
may.
Will come. And when that happens,
sir,
believe
if I
me,
may.
I'll be the happiest one.
If you allow
so
me, 30 seconds.
I'm not
seconds.
Against the state.
Sir,
the
you
idea
talked
of
about
India.
Sir, I don't mean to cut you off. You know,
it's important.
You have today.
The idea of India is important.
Yes.
And
so let me then ask you, sir.
It must be in the hearts and minds of us.
So let me ask you, sir.
It's not about
Article,
the land.
Article 370, Kashmiriyat. Kashmiriyat perhaps mirrors the idea of India, as you say, because it is representative of a composite culture. That's what you have said to me. Now, you have said that you, as a Kashmiri Pandit, I, Rahul Shivshankar, as a Kashmiri Hindu, represent this composite culture best, you have said to me today. Are you speaking for the Ladakhi? Are you speaking for the Jammuite? I'm sure you are, since you represent all Kashmir, Jammu, Ladakh, as you said yourself. They are today happy that this architecture of exclusion, Article 370, has been scrapped or revoked or diluted. Choose whichever adjective. They're very happy. Why are they celebrating? And I just want you to see these pictures, sir, of Ladakhis dancing in the streets. If Article 370 bound them to the mainland, bound them to India, are they rejoicing today, sir, because they are no longer with India? Or are they rejoicing because they are no longer with Kashmir under Article 370? You tell me. Be honest.
You see, Jammu, Kashmir and Ladakh, in our wait and ward, was not an autocratic place. It was not a despot. It was never ruled by us like despots. There was democracy to the extent that people expressed. So there were all shades of opinion.
Huh?
Like you keep labeling every Kashmir, everybody who lives in the Kashmir Valley as Pakistani, equally wrong it is to label. There are various shades of opinion, and I'm sure as a government we have tried, but maybe we have not been able to keep every human being in all parts happy. Like I explained, they are culturally variant areas. Governing Jammu and Kashmir with three different kinds of terrains and three different kinds of aspirations and hopes has been difficult, and it will continue.
So you're
to
being
be
a bit evasive.
For any
I don't want to interrupt you.
One, which is
not you're not
the
answering
new form
my question.
Of
you invoke the composite
I'm
identity
you that, we
that
may have failed.
You.
We may have
no, no. One
failed.
Second, sir. You invoke the composite identity. You told me that you represent. You're representative. As a Kashmiri Pandit, you represent the Ladakhis, the Jammuites, but they are celebrating today. Explain to me this paradox. They're also Kashmiris. How are they celebrating today?
Rahul.
Let me come in, Rahul.
To prove a point, every television channel for the last 1 week has maintained this narrative and shown mainly the main ruling BJP party workers celebrating, which they should, because
so there are only BJP people celebrating all over the state.
They had this in there. It's a matter of generating a narrative, and I don't blame you for to prove your point and your hashtag. Why wouldn't you do that?
Let me then ask you, sir.
I'm not against it.
And let me actually not ask you, but let me point out a fact.
Has been important.
Isn't it a fact, sir? When your leadership has called for poll boycotts, you have been snubbed. And if that is the case, how do you claim that you represent the real Kashmiri and you actually speak for the real Kashmiri or the sentiment? I'll park you with that question. Think about it. I'll open this out further. I have Mr. Prasanna with us also, advocate and senior resident fellow Vidhi Center for Legal Policy.
Sorry.
Now, no, 1 second. I'll just think about it. Let me open this out. There are others also on the panel.
I can be very open.
No, one I minute, can, sir. There are many other shades of opinion, and I want to capture them all. I want to capture them all. I think the Jammu people of India need to hear the different shades.
Largest
Please,
contribution.
Rahul, let me come in.
So give me
because
30
I
seconds.
Have to
I'll come back.
To.
One second, Madhukishwar. I'm coming back to you. I want to bring in Alok Prasanna. Alok Prasanna, look. There are two views on Article 370 and the manner in which it was scrapped. There is a view that I presume that you will present, which will say it's an illegality. There's another view that has been proffered by some other luminaries, legal luminaries, that say that, look, this is well, the government was well within its rights. So I really don't want to get into a legal argument which will be difficult for our viewers to comprehend, because there are two sides and I don't have the second side except for the BJP. But I just want to ask you, sir, today we are now not debating the ends, we are debating the means. And I want to ask you, sir, for 72 years, out of which 68, Kashmir has had Article 370. Despite this, we have seen the lot of the Kashmiri people never improving. It's been what it was, in the main. And this is because you will agree that these very netas who are today fear-mongering have diluted the essence of Article 370 for the last 68 years. Would you agree, sir, through presidential orders and conspired with whoever it was who wanted to do it, they have befooled the people of Jammu and Kashmir for all these many years? Almost six decades, sir.
So I disagree with you that it has stood in the way of development. If you look at the social and economic indicators of Kashmir, they are better than most Indian states. Kashmiris have fewer infant mortality rates, they have longer life rates, and this is because of land reforms just undertaken in the 40s, 50s and 60s. I mean, it's not as if there is some special breed of politician in Kashmir who is corrupt. We know every Indian state has corrupt politicians. We have laws applicable everywhere. Our laws fail us repeatedly again and again and again. And not to say, it's not as if there is some special variant of this which applies in Kashmir. But that is actually, frankly, irrelevant to the whole debate. I think it's very clear that I don't see any benefit to Kashmir from the abrogation of Article 370.
Okay, Mr. Prasanna, at least you are agreeing with me that those that are calling on Kashmiris to rise up today in revolt are not reliable and trustworthy, because they are as corrupt as any other politician, any other political
I
class
don't know them.
In any other part of this country.
Yeah,
so there,
but which,
so here you have an individual.
I don't know. I don't know them personally.
Okay.
I can't
what would you call a group of people?
Frankly, as a lawyer, I'm not competent to do that. And if I'm here to comment
I asked
on
you,
legality,
I asked you a question
so,
which was within your competency. You chose to go on to a political subject. I only asked you whether it was true that Article 370, as it was envisaged by those who brought it on its books, was diluted through many interventions, more than 45 presidential orders. Do you not believe that, sir, to be the case?
No, I mean, your question doesn't make any sense, because when you say dilution, I don't think you understand what that word means.
Right.
Dilution means it becomes weaker. Right. Article 370 being applied to Kashmir does not dilute it. So that is not the right meaning of the word.
You didn't get me.
So I honestly don't understand your question as to what you're expecting
me to
say.
Let me repeat myself.
Article
370 sought to create a special status for Jammu and Kashmir. Over the last six decades, sir, presidential orders have been passed. More than 45 presidential orders were passed to dilute the provisions of Article 370 to allow for laws applicable at the center to extend to Jammu and Kashmir, which was not part of the earlier arrangement. Yes, no.
Your meaning of the word dilute is wrong, because applying, this is the intent of Article 370. It was supposed to give India a way to apply laws to Kashmir with the consent of the government in Kashmir. And if you're going to call that dilution, I disagree on the meaning that you've given to the word dilution. So I can't
answer
that.
Not the consent of the government, sir.
The
consent of the Constituent Assembly. The consent of the Constituent Assembly. which fell apart,
sir. See, they're confusing two different things. I'm sorry you have not read Article 370.
Okay, sir.
No, I'm sorry, I have not
read
Article 370.
The way you have interpreted it.
There are two parts to Article 370.
I haven't read it the way you have interpreted it.
There is Clause 3 which refers to Constituent Assembly. And there is Article... I'm sorry, you have not read it at all. So, I don't see any point in answering your question.
Okay. Fair enough, Mr. Prasanna. Fair enough. Fair enough. You're right. Everyone else is wrong. And this matter will be settled in court. And that's why I said it's difficult to have an argument on legalities. But you are obviously stonewalling on the issue of what turned and what hasn't turned over the last six decades, because it weakens your argument. Fair enough. I want to bring in Madhu Kishwar before I bring in the BJP and Mr. Vivek Kadju.
My argument is legal, so I
Fair
don't know
enough.
What else.
Madhu Kishwar, I want to bring you in on this. These individuals who are fear-mongering, do you believe today they speak for the Kashmiris?
Rahul, even though Samir Kaul is a very, very dear friend of mine, but I would like to differ with him and tell him that this is National Conference party line speaking. It's not a Kashmiri pundit speaking, for the simple reason that Kashmiri pundits have for the first time felt that their existence has been at least recognized by the Indian state. The wrongs done to them have at least been put on record, and some redressal is in sight. As far as Article 370 is concerned, I say it with total emphasis and with full knowledge that what it did is to set up an Islamic state on the secular democratic soil of India, where a small minority of pro-Pak separatists had a veto on everything, and they treated not only Ladakh region but also Jammu, Dogras, Sikhs, Hindus as second class, third class citizens. They did not have equal rights. They would not even allow them to be treated as minorities, which is what they are in that state, and all the benefits that the central government sends for all the beneficial schemes that the central government has made for minorities were cornered only by Kashmiris, Sunni Muslims, not even Shia Muslims, in terms of jobs, in terms of scholarships, in terms of infrastructure, everything. They treated Jammu and Ladakh as colonies, and they treated Hindus and Buddhists and Shia Muslims as second class, third class citizens. It was an Islamic state, and that's why they took it for granted that only a Muslim can be a chief minister, and major portfolios must go only to Kashmir region,
okay,
even though it's a small, tiny part of the overall territory. And I want to share with you some one more thing. You know, when they talk about army and anti-army in the wounds inflicted on Kashmiris have been by their own leaders, NC, PDP, Congress. And I remember what Mehbooba used to tell me. When her father was chief minister, I was a good friend of the family, and she told me on more than one occasion that whenever they removed the army from any village or settlement, people surreptitiously would come and plead with Mufti Saab and say, please army ko wapis lao, because otherwise you're handing us over to the wolves, namely terrorists, who would exploit their women, who would abduct their daughters and sisters, who would exploit them financially and terrorize them. And Mehbooba told me that people actually felt more secure with the army. The fact is that even when the jihadis, the Hurriyat, asked them to boycott Sadbhavna schools set up by the army, when all schools had collapsed, it was the army which was serving the Kashmiris. People defied that. When the army announced home and hearth battalions and tried to recruit, say, 2,000, 3,000 Kashmiris into the army, 80,000 would turn up.
Well, let me tell you, Madhu Kishwar,
of the jihadi boycott of the army.
Let me tell you, Mehbooba Mufti cried in my presence when I met her in Jammu and Kashmir House in the capital. She cried because she said that she felt that she had failed in upholding the true essence of Kashmiriyat, because when I told her about the plight of Kashmiri Hindus like me, she started crying. She started crying, and she said, I couldn't reach out to you, I couldn't provide you security because...
I know Mehbooba too well.
Yes.
But let me... She's... That's drama. not let me make a last point not and then I have to leave. I think this business of thinking that Kashmiris are unhappy, we should look at the fact that Kashmiris have all these decades voted with their feet. Those few who wanted guns went over to Pakistan.
Now,
those who wanted education, jobs, business opportunities came to the rest of the country.
There you
they
go.
They went to Bombay, Delhi, Pune, Trivandrum.
There you go.
Everywhere they spread out and bought properties.
There
if
you go.
Kashmiris were really anti-India, why would
go.
They buy properties? Why would they set up businesses in the
unfortunately,
rest of
viewers,
India? That's not
Alok
how
Prasanna,
you see the
advocate
you
and
hate.
Senior resident fellow, has recused himself from this debate. He didn't answer my question. He said that this particular article.
Thank God.
No,
because
no.
He's talking
One
nonsense.
Second. That this particular article. I don't share your opinion on when you say that presidential orders were issued to dilute it. He said, I quibble with your definition of dilution. Now, let me inform him. I wish he was here to listen to this. I don't know where he's gone, but perhaps he didn't have the patience. The Kashmiri netas, viewers, who are misleading the Kashmiris today and fear-mongering, will not tell the people of Kashmir how they sold them down the drain. And let me point out three instances. In 1964 December, when G.M. Sadiq was Delhi appointed Prime Minister of the state since February 1964, the central government extended Article 356 and 357 of the Constitution, whereunder the center could dismiss any elected government in any state, including Jammu and Kashmir, whereby it was therefore brought on par with other states of India. I thought the Farooq Abdullahs and his daddy, Sheikh Abdullah, had negotiated special powers and a special status for Kashmir where precisely this kind of action would not happen. What do you call that? You call that collusion. So why should today, and I want to ask you, Mr. Lone, you're a representative, and I want to also bring in the BJP and Mr. Katchu, who's been very patiently listening in. I want to bring you in, Mr. Lone. Who sold you? Who sold you by diluting through presidential orders these article, this Article 370? Who sold you? Tell me, who sold you?
Rahul, everybody.
Who sold you?
See.
Who sold you?
Don't divert.
No, I'm asking
Please
you, who
don't
sold
divert.
You? You answer
let
the big
me,
question.
Let
Did
me,
the Abdullah
let
sell
me.
You out? Did the Mufti sell you out? Yes, no.
Everyone.
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 Now stop.
But
now
no,
stop.
No, no, no,
no,
no, no,
no,
no, but,
no,
but,
no, but
that was
wait,
the.
Wait, wait.
Now let
wait.
Me, let me.
At
there
least
was
you have
erogens,
the courage of
there
conviction.
There was erogens.
That Alok
there was
have.
Erogens.
He didn't answer my question.
And we erosion, time and again demanded
that, are being
that
used.
Those
now
erogens
wait.
Be reversed.
Be reversed.
Even when Sheikh Abdullah entered
reversed,
into the
sir?
Indira Sheikh
how will
Accord,
they be reversed?
His demand
how
was to restore what is snatched by the Delhi.
How can that
and
have
Indira
happened?
Gandhi told him
yes.
that the clock can't be set
naturally,
back.
Once
yes.
you sell,
but the question
you can't
is,
buy back.
The J&K Assembly passed
okay.
the resolution
okay.
recommending the restoration of autonomy.
Right.
And let me tell
but
you,
did it come
the
to
interlocutors,
you? Did it come to you?
The working group.
Did it come to you, sir? Did it come to you? Did it come to you, Mr. Lone?
Sagir
did it come to you?
Recommended strongly.
Answer me this question. Did it come to you, Mr. Lone?
Government's decision.
Did it come to you, Mr. Lone?
To backstabbing.
Did it come to you, Mr. Lone?
Fraud.
Did it come to you, Mr. Lone? Did it come to you, Mr. Lone? It didn't come to you. Why? Because the dalals were standing in the middle of people like you who wanted full restoration of autonomy and the Indian state. That is the problem. And those. Same dalals
no,
today.
Why you are debating what about today's decision?
Calm down.
Isn't it?
Please
isn't
stop
it,
shouting.
Backstabbing?
I haven't shouted.
Isn't it a constitutional
Just calm
fraud?
Down. Just
You're
calm
deciding
down.
About
Just calm
us
down. Can you give me 30 seconds?
Us into the
no, no, 1 second.
Though the Article 3
one
of
second,
Indian
sir.
Constitution provides
Can you stop
that
shouting?
The Assembly's opinion is must.
Can you
now
stop
you are
shouting?
That
Can you stop shouting? Listen, there are two people who haven't spoken. In fact, there are three people, Mr. Lone, who haven't spoken on this debate. Let them speak.
The Article 3 file.
Let them speak. Let them speak. Show some courtesy, sir. Show some courtesy.
Today,
please.
Rahul,
one
we
minute.
Are victims.
I want to bring in Mr. Katchu and Mr. Malviya.
Identity.
Mr. Malviya, one minute.
Our honor, our dignity.
1 minute.
Try to understand
calm
our
down.
Pain.
Calm down.
And
calm
you
down.
Don't have
okay,
an iota of concern.
Are you going to keep talking or I will have to lower your fader? Because if I have to lower your fader, then it's a pointless debate. So don't do that.
I'm making Let's some valid,
I've come to you, sir.
Valid points.
Are there not
points.
Other people on this debate panel? I'm coming to you. Relax. Thank you. Show some patience. Okay. Mr. Kaju, Mr. Malviya first. Mr. Malviya, presidential orders were issued over the years. Who were the governments in Jammu and Kashmir at that point who implemented these presidential orders, who facilitated them and betrayed Kashmiris? Can you recall for me, sir?
Look, Rahul, I don't think this is the first time that a presidential order has been issued to make an amendment to Article 370, and in this case it has been completely done away with.
Yes.
The problem with those who are outraging today is that their monopoly over Kashmir and the resources that were sent to Kashmir now stands withdrawn. It's the Kashmiri elites. Mufti and Abdullah's are the face of it, in collusion with the Congress party here in the center, for all these years have basically milked the state for their personal gains. And the average Kashmiri has actually got nothing in return. If you look at what 370 does, it in fact bars people from getting social reservations to the OBC, to the tribals, to the Dalits, of which a very large number of people live in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. It is anti-women.
It does not give them equal rights. I am on the larger point tonight. Who do we believe? Do we believe the fear mongers, or do we believe the Union of India as represented by the centre? And Mr. Kaju and Tawseef are there with us. Alok Prasanna has chosen to recuse himself. He didn't have many answers to give tonight. He certainly couldn't take my question. But I want you to come in, Mr. Kaju. Thank you for being so patient tonight. It's not been easy. Who do we believe tonight? The fearmongers or the Indian state? Who do we believe?
Rahul, if you permit, let me sketch out how I see the situation, and please be, I've been patient, so please be patient for with me just for 30 seconds,
right,
perhaps 45 seconds. I believe that right in 1947, there was a bargain struck wherein the Indian state assured the Kashmiri elite, the then Kashmiri elite, which was a valley-based elite, that in exchange for autonomy, they will give up the idea of independence and or going to Pakistan. Now, the fact is that many in the Kashmir Valley did not adhere to this idea of autonomy and started flirting with different independence, etc. But there were also sections of Indian opinion, political opinion, which felt very strongly that the Indian state should not permit any autonomous region at all, and that's a perfectly valid way of ordering a polity. You can have a polity with autonomous units, one or two, or you can have a polity with a certain uniformity. Now, the fact is that even with autonomy, and this answers your question of dilution, that even with autonomy, there are many areas where the assimilative powers of the union had to extend to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, because the original instrument of accession spoke only of foreign policy, communications and defense. Now, it is inconceivable that when things start operating, it will the autonomy can be maintained by a particular unit within a a polity or a constitutional order, only in respect of these things. Just let me complete this. Therefore, today we've reached a situation where the government of the day, which believes that there should not be any autonomous units, there should be uniformity, and it has made no secret of its ideological position. It goes back right to the very beginning of after independence, has, because it has a mandate, has applied its position, and there are people who believe, I for one believe that technically, in the matter, I am no constitutional expert, but I do believe that technically they've done it within the boundaries of our constitution. Now, the fact is that at the end of the day, the facts, the situation on the ground will prevail. And since I've had a career in foreign policy, my fear is, and the Pakistanis have shown their hand partially today.
Yes.
But my fear is that the intrusive capacities that the Pakistanis have built
there
in the Kashmir Valley, and especially, will now come into play. And
will
therefore,
come
the
into
government
play.
Will have to meet
and
that
I think,
challenge.
Mr. Kachu, you have been so prescient
and
tonight.
I do think.
You have been so prescient because this is the news we are breaking. I am being told.